Thank you. Good morning. I'm Wes Parham, Director of Business and Professional Development for the Colorado Association of Realtors, and I want to thank you for joining us today. As you know, six new rules went into effect last month under the direction of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, or the CFPB, and those rules, of course, do have an impact on our industry, and we're fortunate to have Terry Jones with us this morning to walk us through how those items will impact your buyers and your sellers and your business. And Terry will also be available to answer your questions and point us in the direction of other resources out there to get follow-up information. And I look forward to turning the program over to him in just a few moments. But first, I wanted to pass along a quick thank you to First American Title for their support in presenting our webcast program, which is part of our professional development initiative at CAR. And of course, we're very happy to have them as a partner in that regard, more appreciative of their continued support. I also have a few quick housekeeping items this morning. We've allocated an hour and a half for today's presentation with a 10-minute break scheduled at about 10 o'clock. If you have any questions along the way, please feel free to type those in according to the instructions there on your screen. What we do is we collect those, we review them during the break, and we'll come back and have Terry address as many as he can afterward. And finally, a link to a copy of the PowerPoint and other materials that Terry might be referencing today can be accessed in the area below the video stream that you're watching right now. We would encourage you to submit those questions along the way. If you have any problems accessing those or other questions, please just send a note to the email address in front of you. So with that, our speaker this morning, as I mentioned, is Terry Jones. Terry is co-chair of the Colorado Mortgage Lenders Association, or the CMLA, Legislative and Regulatory Affairs Committee. He brings more than 40 years of experience to the industry and has served in many facets of lending. He is also the former president of CMLA, where he remains actively involved, and we're pleased to have him here. So at this time, I'd like to welcome Terry Jones. And Terry, thanks again for letting us borrow your time and expertise this morning. I'll give you the remainder of the hour to go into some detail on some of these hot topics.
Well, thank you, Wes. And it's a pleasure to be with you all today to talk about the new era of regulation in all of our industry. It was my privilege. I spent the first 20 years of my career working at Moore Mortgage Company, which was part of Moore Realty. And so it's been my privilege through the years to work with many of you in the Colorado Association of Realtors. So why don't we get started here? I'm going to talk today about the six new rules that Wes mentioned, but I'm going to talk particularly, I think, the last half of the presentation here. We'll be talking about seller carryback financing, because these rules do have an impact on that, and I think that's probably one of the biggest areas where we'll see that. But let's start by talking a little bit about the CFPB. We'll just go through this quickly. But the CFPB was created by Title 10 of the Dodd-Frank Act, and it became operational on July 21st, 2011. It's an independent agency within the Federal Reserve System. It has an independent director, which is confirmed by the Senate. It has an independent budget, roughly $500 million a year, paid by the Federal Reserve System. And it has independent rulemaking, research, congressional testimony, enforcement powers, and litigation capability. You'll notice all the way through this, there's the stress is on independent. And that was exactly what I think Congress had in mind when they set this up. CFPB has a broad consumer protection mandate. Their objective is to have a single federal agency to receive, manage, and respond to consumer financial complaints. And further, it ensures that consumers are protected from unfair, deceptive, or abusive acts and practices, as well as from discrimination. They're guided by the Title 10 mandate that the market should be fair, transparent, and competitive. The CFPB has a supervisory authority and enforcement authority over very large deposit institutions and credit unions with over $10 billion in assets. They also have enforcement and supervisory authority over all of the non-bank financial institutions, and of course that includes all of the mortgage lending operations, I think, that you're probably familiar with, both mortgage banking companies as well as mortgage brokerage, down to individual loan officers. They do have a limited authority over smaller institutions and credit unions, but they still make the rules. The difference is that the rules are enforced by those smaller institutions, I guess you could say, prudential regulators. And there's a difference between the CFPB and a prudential regulator would be like the FDIC or the OCC or the SEC. A prudential regulator is charged with considering not only what's good for consumers, but also considering what's good for the health of the industry. The CFPB's charge is solely to protect consumers. So they are not a prudential regulator in that sense, although they have been very good about reaching out to the industry and listening and taking input. The CFPB has rulemaking authority over 19 what they call enumerated consumer laws. We'll list, show you those in a minute here. And they also have enforcement authority and rulemaking over Title 10, the unfair, deceptive, and abusive acts or practices. And this is where you get into a lot of advertising kinds of issues and so forth. So the CFPB has control over almost all of the laws that you're used to dealing with regards to real estate. So for instance, RESPA, the Real Estate Settlement Procedures Act, the Truth in Lending Act, the Equal Credit Opportunity Act, the Fair Credit Reporting Act, pretty much, and I'm not going to go through all of these here today, but the idea is that the CFPB is the new, they're in charge of all of the laws that really affect our industry on a day-to-day basis with regards to our interactions with consumers. Now, the CFPB has very broad investigatory and enforcement powers. They can issue subpoenas. They can issue civil investigative demands. They can issue cease and desist orders. They can commence civil actions. They can do administrative procedures based on those cease and desist orders. They can enforce FTC regulations regarding unfair and deceptive practices. And in taking enforcement actions, and this is one of the things that CFPB really has unprecedented power, in that they can enforce the rescission or reformation of contracts, they can enforce and require the refund of monies, the return of real property, restitution, they can enforce the disgorgement of profits, and a list of other things here. And again, that one of the key things is they can fine with civil money penalties for violations up to $5,000 a day per occurrence for any violation, up to $25,000 a day for what they consider to be reckless violations, and they can fine an entity up to $1 million a day for knowing violations. So those are very severe penalties. They have very broad powers, and that's one of the reasons I think that you see that lenders and all of the people who are directly affected by the CFPB are paying very careful attention to their new rules and regulations and trying very hard to make sure that they're in compliance. And as with any new regulation, there's always going to be a period of time where the industry does the best they can to conform to the rules and regulations, and then as the CFPB continues to review, continues to examine lenders and other people in their enforcement sphere, then we'll start to see a little bit more interpretation based on the kind of enforcement actions that they've taken. So I think that these rules will become clearer and clearer as we move forward. Now, at this point, Wes mentioned the six new rules that we're talking about. And the six new rules are the Equal Credit Opportunity Act valuations rule, which was effective on the 18th of January, the Truth in Lending Act, Higher Priced Mortgage Loan Appraisal Rule, which was effective January 18th, the 2013 RESPA and TILA Mortgage Servicing Rules, which were effective January 10th, the 2013 Homeownership and Equity Protection Act, which is commonly called HOPA Rule, which was effective January 10th, the 2013 Mortgage Loan Originator Rule, effective on January 1st, with a few provisions effective on January 10th. And then finally, and this is probably the biggest one I think that will have the most impact, is the Ability to Repay Rule and Qualified Mortgage Rule, which also was effective on January 10th. So let's talk about, starting with the Equal Credit Opportunity Act valuations rule. As far as how this, you might see some impacts in your day-to-day business. This is effective for loan applications received on or after January 18th, and it requires creditors to disclose to applicants within 3 days of application that they have the right to receive copies of appraisals and written valuations. Now, that's really not the policy of making those available isn't anything new. Most lenders have made those available to people upon request. The difference now is we're required, and we do, notify people that they're entitled to those copies. And the other thing that's different about this is that this rule requires that the creditor automatically send a free copy of all appraisals and other written valuations, not just the appraisal. So for instance, if a lender runs an AVM, an automated valuation model, if they have broker price opinions, if they're written, then the borrower is going to receive copies of those directly from the lender. And the requirement is that they're provided promptly upon completion and no later than 3 days prior to the consummation or the closing, whichever occurs first. So what this means, and I think that everybody needs to be aware of, and again, as we go through this process of getting used to this, but borrowers are going to be getting more than one indication of value from the lender, because there's certainly no guarantee that if an AVM is ordered, that that's going to agree with the appraisal. Could be higher, could be lower, and so that it's one of those things that I think everybody just needs to be aware of. And as we go through this, we'll get a sense of it. But certainly, the markets that we've been through, and with people using or buyers using some of these values, maybe to reopen the negotiations on a contract, it's something that you might want to be aware of, because an AVM, certainly, as we all know, is not the final appraised value of the property, but it's still going to be out there, and the borrower will have the opportunity to view those during the process of processing the loan. The valuations rule does permit charging the applicant a reasonable fee to cover the cost of preparing appraisals and other written valuations, so that's still the way things have been. It does prohibit, however, charging for copies of those appraisals, even if they haven't paid the permitted fee up front. So I think what you may see is lenders that are going to charge for appraisals up front may be somewhat more insistent that they get paid that money before the process starts, because certainly once the appraisal comes in, that goes to the borrower regardless of whether they've paid the fee or not. It does prohibit the upcharging of consumers by adding fees to the cost of preparing appraisals. So in other words, a lender can't go in and anticipate that they're going to be giving out lots of free copies of appraisals and thereby raise the charge that the appraiser is charging them. That's not permitted under this law. The Truth in Lending Higher Priced Mortgage Loan Rule, this really deals, I think, the biggest impact here is that it requires that an additional appraisal be ordered if the property is determined to be a flip. And it does define when a property is considered a flip. This is one I don't think is really going to be something that we need to spend a lot of time on today, so I'm just going to move right across this. One thing to mention here, all of these rules are entitled, or at least many of them are, the 2013, like this one, 2013 RESPA and TILA mortgage rule. That's because they were issued in January of 2013, a year ago. And then the date of final implementation was set a year later. So the industry has spent the last year getting ready to implement these rules, and we're very thankful that the CFPB gave us that year to get ready, because a lot of these rules did require a lot of reprogramming of computer systems and so forth. So anyway, the 2013 RESPA and TILA mortgage servicing final rules, went into effect January 10th. They deal with nine major areas, error resolution and information requests. They have requirements for lenders to respond quickly. They have limits on force-placed insurance. They require general servicing policies, procedures, and requirements in terms of accessing and providing timely and accurate information, properly evaluating loss mitigation applications, the facilitation, oversight of, and compliance by service providers. In other words, what that's saying is that lenders are responsible for the vendors that do business with them. So it's not just the lender's own employees that they have to be concerned about, or the servicer's own employees. If they outsource any of the services that they provide, the lender remains responsible for the service provided by the vendor. There are requirements for facilitating the transfer of information during servicing transfers. There have been instances, and there was even a law passed here in Colorado a year ago, where borrowers in loan modifications whose servicing was transferred from one servicer to another, those records somehow got lost. There were problems in getting that done, and so they wound up having to start over at the new servicer. That's no longer permitted by the CFPB, and of course there's a Colorado law that makes that illegal as well. So the new servicer has to honor the old servicer's applications and continue processing them, and if their people are eligible for a loss mitigation or for a loan modification, then they need to pick up the ball and run with it and make those decisions without requiring new applications. There are requirements for record retention and also for servicing file maintenance and production requirements for documentation. There are requirements for early intervention with delinquent customers. As many of you know, in the foreclosure problems that have existed around the country, we've been fortunate in Colorado in that I don't think we have not had as severe a problem with this as some of the other states. But nevertheless, there are now mandated requirements for early intervention with delinquent consumers. And live customer contact requirements and timeframes. So when a borrower becomes delinquent, the CFPB lays out the requirements for when they need to be contacted, the minimum standard for contact. Certainly lenders are free to go beyond that. And then there's a requirement to provide loss mitigation options and to let people know what the loss mitigation options are. There's a requirement for continuity of contact with delinquent customers. The requirements for the kind of people, and they need to be knowledgeable and able to respond to the consumer about the consumer's individual transactions. And it sets forth the scope of capabilities that those people are required to have. And really, when you think about this, a lot of these are sound business practices. The industry, I think, was overwhelmed with the volume of foreclosures as the real estate meltdown happened in the late part of the decade of the first decade of the 2000s. But what we've seen is that as the industry has staffed up, we've seen these problems have gone down to some degree, and then of course the CFPB has now mandated the minimum standard of requirements that lenders are required to deal with. In terms of loss mitigation, there are requirements and timeframes for acknowledging and evaluating loss mitigation options. There are timelines for requiring response to consumers on if they don't have a complete loss mitigation application. We need to reach out to them quickly and let them know what is needed to complete it. If the loss mitigation application should be denied, there are requirements for an appeals process that requires that the same, you have to use a different group of people if a loss mitigation application were to be declined, the appeals process needs to go through a different group of people who have the power to reverse that first decision if necessary. There are prohibitions and limitations on dual tracking. Dual tracking is a process that, because the foreclosure process, and again, this is more of a nationwide problem. I think it was more of a problem in some of the states back east than it was here in Colorado. But there were instances of this problem in Colorado. Dual tracking is the process by which a borrower, the foreclosure process is begun and continues to proceed forward at the same time that the borrower's loss mitigation application is being considered. And what happened in a few very unfortunate situations is that there were situations, and again, very few of these in Colorado, but some, where a borrower who had gone through a loss mitigation application because the left hand and with some of the big servicers didn't know what the right hand was doing, the foreclosure process went ahead, and even though they had applied for a loss mitigation application, the property was foreclosed. That is absolutely addressed in these new rules, and I think it is addressed well. I don't think we're going to see that as a problem again. And then there are limitations on when we can begin and when the foreclosure process can be completed. And again, that it revolves around the loss mitigation applications. Further, there are certain new requirements for interest rate adjustment notices for ARMs, so that borrowers whose ARMs are going to adjust have plenty of notice on when it's going to adjust, what the adjustments are going to be. There are requirements for prompt crediting of mortgage payments and quick responses, timelines for responses to requests for payoff amounts. Again, that's something I think that we'll all benefit from is quicker processing of payoff requests. There's a requirement for periodic statements for mortgage loans, which again means that there are going to be more lenders sending a monthly statement to borrowers. And there are provisions for coupon books, but again, there are sort of minimum standards being set by the CFPB. And finally, they do recognize that small servicers, be they community banks or small mortgage banking servicing operations where the servicing is under 5,000 loans, and some of the rules that we're talking about here in a small portfolio really don't apply because you don't have the problem where you've got the right hand not knowing what the left hand is doing because you don't have that many employees involved. So there are exemptions for those entities who service less than 5,000 loans on an annual basis. And again, typically those are going to be community banks and small mortgage banking types of operations. Now, the 2013, the next three rules that we're going to talk about here are the rules I think that are going to have the most impact on seller financing. And so Homeownership Equity and Protection Act, the new rule that's in place as of January 10th, what it does is it lowers the previous thresholds for defining a high-cost mortgage. There are sort of three tiers of mortgages, if you want to think about it. There is the loan, we'll talk about the qualified mortgage here in a minute, but there's the basic sort of vanilla loan that we're all used to, the 30-year fixed rate loan, FHA, VA, conventional loan, maybe saleable to Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac. That's sort of the basic, if you will, loan. Then there are what they call higher priced mortgage loans that are very similar to the vanilla product, except they generally have a little bit higher cost to the consumer, and therefore there are higher levels of protection. And then the final category is the high cost mortgage loan, and This is where they require additional disclosures, and they have additional protections for the consumer. So it's kind of a tiered level of protections that the CFPB provides. So anyway, this rule includes home equity lines of credit, HELOCs, as potential high-cost mortgages. It does require, as I said, additional disclosures. It prohibits certain loan terms. It requires that the consumer receive additional protections, including home ownership counseling, if they're going to apply for a loan that's HOPA. This also would cover a lot of what is typically termed hard money lending, where the interest rates are quite a bit higher. The threshold here is that the interest rate, the APR, is probably somewhere around 6.5% higher than the going rate. So it's we'll talk about that a little more in the question and answer. I don't think there are many loans that are going to fall into this category. Again, we'll just keep moving here. But one of the things in this rule that does apply to all borrowers, or pretty much all borrowers, is that as I said, it requires loan counseling from approved HUD counselors for anyone who is involved in applying for a high-cost mortgage loan. But it also goes on to say and to require that any applicant for a federally related mortgage loan, so this would be most of the loans that we're dealing with, that it's required that they receive a list of housing counselors in their area. Then they need to be supplied with a list of 10. Now, whether they decide to use those housing counselors or not is going to be up to the borrower, but it's a new requirement that they do need to receive that list. It also goes on to define what's included in calculating points and fees for HOPA coverage, as well as what loan origination compensation must be included in the point and fees calculation. It goes on to add a prepayment penalty coverage test. So let's talk about the loan originator rule very briefly. Again, this was effective January 1st for loans that were consummated after January 1st and where the loan originator gets paid on or after January 1st. It prohibits the use of mandatory arbitration clauses and waivers of federal claims in court in loan agreements. It prohibits the financing of credit insurance. It requires the use of the NMLS ID, that's the National Mortgage Licensing System and Registry. And every loan originator out there and every mortgage loan company, every bank has an ID number that's unique to that individual. And those have to appear starting last month, on the loan application, the note, and the security instrument, which of course in Colorado would be the deed of trust. And probably the key point in this loan originator rule is that it expands the definition of who is considered a loan originator. And we're going to talk about that in a little bit when we start talking about seller financing. But that's a key point to remember. It does prohibit compensation to an originator based on the terms of the loan, or what they call a proxy for a term of the loan. The only permissible way that an originator can be paid is on the one term that is allowed that they can be paid on is the loan amount. But they can't be paid a different amount if the interest rate is higher or lower. That's not a consideration. The rule is applicable to a compensation that's both paid and received, which means that, and this is just like RESPA, it's just as illegal to pay illegal compensation as it is to receive illegal compensation. It establishes certain categories of permissible retirement or bonus profit-based compensation plans. So it does give some ways that lenders, certainly the lending industry was migrating towards a profit-based system, so more profitable loans an originator might expect to be paid, and this is in the old days, a somewhat higher commission as they would on a less profitable loan. That's no longer permitted except with some very limited circumstances around qualified retirement plans and so forth. It defines who may pay the originator compensation and under what circumstances. It sets forth the qualifications for originators to be loan originators. It establishes requirements for companies that employ originators. And finally, it sets record-keeping requirements. And again, this is primarily due to keeping payroll records so that the CFPB can and will examine in an audit to make sure that those originators are being paid in accordance with the rules that they've set. So now the big rule here, the ability to repay rule and qualified mortgage rule, and typically the name of the rule is the ability to repay rule. But it does establish the qualified mortgage, so a lot of times you'll see it called the QM or the QM rule. It's effective with all loans taken on January 10th of 2014. It requires, and this doesn't sound like an unreasonable requirement, it requires that every creditor make a reasonable, good faith determination before or when consummating a mortgage loan that the consumer has a reasonable ability to repay the loan. You may recall that there were kinds of loans, the no income, no asset verification loans, where decisions were made on the basis of what the loan to value ratio was, with the assumption that properties were going to continue to appreciate, which is, we now know, not necessarily something that you can count on. Those kinds of loans you're not able to make anymore under this, under the ability to repay rule. It provides a standard for determining the borrower's ability to repay. So they don't just say you have to do it, they set requirements for what is required to do that. It establishes a category of loans called the qualified mortgage, or the QM, where the creditor is presumed to have complied with the ability to repay if the loan that's originated meets the QM standard. And this is one of the areas we think that an awful lot of lenders are going to, at least at first, confine themselves to originating loans within the QM standard. Now, the good news is that most of the loans that are being originated, most of the loans that were being originated over the last few years are going to fit within the QM standard. The QM definition introduces some things that are going to be more and more prevalent, I guess you could say. First of all, it sets a 3-point cap on fees. If the loan fees are higher than 3 points, the loan won't be a QM, and I think you're going to see that lenders are less likely to make loans that aren't QMs. It does institute a maximum 43% debt-to-income ratio for the loan to be a QM. That's less of a problem because there's a category down here, a couple of bullet points down, called a temporary QM, which essentially says that loans that are eligible for sale to Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac, for as long as they are in conservatorship, which they are right now and probably will remain there for some time, or for a maximum time period of 7 years, that as long as the loan is eligible for sale to Fannie or Freddie, then, and of course, both Fannie and Freddie have automated underwriting systems. So if it's approved and approved accept for Fannie Mae, for instance, then it does have a temporary QM status for that loan, which means even if the loan exceeds the 43% maximum debt to income ratio, it's still going to be a QM. It's still going to be made. The loan's still going to be made by the lender. It introduces the concept of the safe harbor QM. And what that means is that if a loan falls within the guidelines that are set for a QM, then a lender is presumed to have complied with the ability to repay rule. However, if it exceeds the category, and this is where we taught the where you get into high-priced mortgage loans. So if it exceeds the requirement, and the requirement for the primary requirement for a safe harbor is that the for a standard QM is that the annual percentage rate of the loan being made cannot exceed the average offered rate, which is tracked by the CFPB, it can't exceed that by more than 1.5%. So if it's less than 1.5%, then it is a standard QM. If it's more than 1.5%, then it's a high-priced mortgage loan. And in a rebuttable presumption, that what that says, it's still presumed to be a QM, but the borrower has enhanced rights to challenge the lender on whether that loan was done properly. We talked about the temporary QMs, and then again for small creditors, those small community banks and so forth, there's a particular QM category for them as well. The reason that people are paying so much attention to this has a lot to do with the penalties. First of all, the penalties for violating the ability to repay rule are expanded. In the old truth in lending rules, the borrower had a year if they felt that they had been wronged under truth in lending. Now that time frame has been expanded to 3 years. In that they can assert that the lender didn't properly evaluate their ability to repay. In the case of defending against a foreclosure, it removes the time limit altogether. So a borrower can assert at any time a foreclosure were to happen, if it's 4 years, 5 years, 6 years down the road, the borrower can still raise the defense that the lender didn't properly consider the ability to repay. And we expect that defense will probably be raised in more often than not as we go forward. Also, Dodd-Frank itself prohibits a loan originator from steering a borrower to a loan where the borrower doesn't have the ability to repay the loan. So this doesn't apply only to lending organizations. It also applies to individual loan originators. And originators could be subject to personal liability for up to 3 times the amount of their earnings on a loan in question if they steer a borrower to a loan where it's ultimately determined that the borrower does not have the ability to repay. So these things are all the reasons, I think, why lending within the QM space is going to be important, at least at first, for a lot of lenders trying to make sure that they're doing everything properly and limiting their liability. Now let's talk a little bit about seller or private financing. Because seller financing can be impacted by the Truth in Lending Act, the Ability to Repay Rule, the 2013 Homeownership and Equity Protection Act, the HOPA rule, and also by the Loan Originator Rule. And you've probably all seen this. This is the new language in the contract to buy or sell. That deals with seller or private financing. And the reason, again, that this is important for everybody to keep in mind is, and I wanted to expand a little bit on the penalties that we were just talking about, because I think there is likely to be considerable liability for errors in failing to properly advise sellers, buyers, and real estate brokers involved in seller financing. So, licensed real estate brokers and mortgage loan originators really should carefully consider. I know it's the official position of the Colorado Association of Realtors. It's also the official position of the Colorado Mortgage Lenders Association that a licensed real estate broker or a licensed mortgage loan originator would be well advised to engage the services of a licensed Colorado attorney who's knowledgeable in the areas of seller financing, the ability to repay rule, the loan officer compensation rule, and the Truth in Lending Act and HOPA to help advise sellers and themselves in handling these kinds of transactions. So the buyer and borrower, the penalties, the buyer and borrower, buyer-borrower, I'm sorry, may be able to recover special statutory damage equal to the sum of all the finance charges paid by that borrower in addition to, it's all of the finance charges in the first 3 years, and I've got an example on the next slide here, the damages and also their court fees. And also in a foreclosure, so that's limited to the first 3 years, but after that, it can still be raised if the loan goes into foreclosure. So what that might, how much that could be on if you look at a $200,000 loan with a 5% down payment, if you look at the 4% interest, and it's a 4% loan, for $200,000, the 3 years of finance charges is $23,000. 5% down payment. Again, the idea behind a down payment, why that would be a damage, is if the loan, if the loan was made in violation of the ability to repay consideration, then that means that the loan shouldn't have been made in the first place, which means that part of their damages is going to be all of the, any down payment, any closing costs, any of those kinds of things. So, and then of course, if it goes to court, the attorney's fees can easily add up to $50,000. So a seller who does this improperly and winds up getting sued by the buyer and loses could be looking at a loss somewhere in the high five figures on a $200,000 property. So that's the reason I think it's so important that, that attorneys need to be engaged and advising all the way through this process to make sure that it's done properly and to minimize any liability that that might occur later on down the road. Okay, so the considerations under federal law and regulation. A seller carrying back a financing transaction will likely fall under the Truth in Lending Act, because the ability to repay is part of the Truth in Lending Act, in one of two ways. The most likely circumstance that will cause a seller to fall under Truth in Lending as a loaner is because they can easily be defined as a loan originator. And we'll talk about the definition here in a minute, and you can see why. There is also a possibility that a lender could fall under Truth in Lending as a creditor under a couple of circumstances that I think are a little bit more remote. So we'll talk about those later. And finally, the thing is, a seller carrying back seller financing would be considered a loan originator if they meet the definition of a loan originator under the 2013 loan originator rule. And so here's the rule for everybody. I'm not going to sit here and read it to you, but basically what this boils down to is the loan originator rule defines a loan originator as any person who offers or negotiates the terms of a residential mortgage loan. So for a seller to carry back a loan, somebody's going to have to offer or negotiate the terms of the loan between the buyer and the seller. And this is also where realtors need to be careful, is because while there are exemptions under the law for realtors acting as, or for real estate brokers acting as, and doing the business of real estate brokerage, if they act as loan originators, which again is offering or negotiating terms, then they can easily be defined as a loan originator as well. And that's why, again, the loan originator rule, and remember I highlighted earlier that it broadens the definition of who's considered a loan originator. This is exactly what we're talking about here. Now, the good news is that the loan officer compensation rule provides two exemptions from being defined as a loan originator for sellers carrying back seller financing. This doesn't apply to anybody but a seller. So, and there's two, seller financing for one property, and then seller financiers three properties. And for those of you that are interested, and I would encourage anybody who's considering doing this, you need to, number one, you need to engage an attorney. But also I provided the citations in the law for those who really want to look at it. So the seller financiers one property exemption is available to a natural person, estate, or trust that meets all of the following criteria, and they're not considered a loan originator in if they meet all these criteria. So first of all, and a key factor is they can only sell one property in any 12-month period and carry back the financing. Second, they cannot have constructed that property or acted as a contractor to construct the property in the ordinary course of business. So in other words, if they're a person, if this is the home they've always lived in, something like that, if it's the estate of their parents, and there's one home, there's only one transaction that's going to happen in any 12-month period, so far they're gonna fit under this. And then the financing has to have a payment schedule that does not result in negative amortization. Key factor here for everybody is that the balloon payments are permissible under the single exemption for seller financiers one property. There are also some requirements for adjustable rate mortgages. So the interest rate either has to be fixed, or if it's adjustable, It has to be adjustable after 5 years. And if it's an adjustable rate, there has to be reasonable annual and lifetime caps on the rate increases, which they've defined at CFPB as defined as 2% annual and 6% lifetime. And if the index has to be on the adjustable rate, has to be widely available, such as the indices for U.S. Treasury securities or the LIBOR index, London Interbank Offered Rate. So under the seller financier's one property exemption, a seller financier is not covered by the Truth in Lending Act, the Ability to Repay Rule, or the Loan Originator Rule, so long as they meet all of these requirements. And this is the one I think that is going to make the most sense for most sellers. It's the broadest exemption. Now, for those people who have more than one property that they might want to carry back in a three-month period, there is the seller financier's three properties exemption. Now, the difference here is that if someone is in a position, and that maybe this is somebody who owns some investment properties or something like that, again, same kind of rules apply. They can't have constructed the property or acted as a contractor for the construction of the property. They've got pretty much the same rules. The loan has to be fully amortizing. The difference here, though, there is a difference. Because it is fully amortizing, that means no balloon payments are permissible under the three property exemption rule. And the other big thing is the financing is one that the person determines in good faith the consumer has a reasonable ability to repay. So again, here the ability to repay reaches or starts to occur here. Now, the thing to keep in mind is that it has the same rules, and I won't go through these again, it has the same rules as the single property exemption as far as if it's an adjustable rate mortgage. So the thing is here, you've got to keep in mind the ability to repay is now in play if your seller is operating under the three exemption rule. Now the good news is the CFPB has provided an alternative criteria for seller financiers, because the criteria for the ability to repay rule for a creditor, which is what all lenders are, is much more detailed than the what we're going to talk about here. But the seller still needs to arrive at the conclusion that the borrower, and again, now we're talking about the three loan exception here. If you're under the single loan exception, you don't have to consider, the seller does not have to consider the buyer-borrower's ability to repay. But when you're under the three exemption rule, they do provide this relaxed criteria. And what it says is that if the borrower intends to make payments from income, the seller needs to consider evidence of the borrower's current or reasonably expected income. So for instance, payroll statements, earnings statements, form W-2s, similar forms used for reporting wages or tax withholding or military leave and earnings statements. If the borrower intends to make payments from other income, such as Social Security and so forth, the seller needs to consider the sources of those payments, and they need to look at the information. If they intend to make payments from income earned from assets, then the seller needs to consider the income from relevant assets, such as funds held in accounts with financial institutions, equity ownership interests, or rental property. They still need to look at this stuff, but the CFPB doesn't require that the documentation be kept. That's one of the key differences between this rule and the ability to repay rule for a lender or for a creditor, is that it's required that not only are these, do you have to consider this income, but you have to verify it, and then you have to retain evidence that you did do all of that stuff. Here, the CFPB doesn't require that you retain the evidence. They still require that you consider it, but they don't require that you retain the evidence. And we'll talk about that here in a second on the next slide. But the comment, and again, I mentioned this earlier, the comment does make clear that the value of the dwelling that secures the financing doesn't constitute evidence of the borrower's ability to repay. So the very fact that a borrower makes a 50% down payment doesn't have anything to do with whether the borrower has the ability to repay. So if you're in one of these three the exemption for three loans, you need to be careful, your seller needs to be careful not to consider the down payment because as evidence of their ability to repay. Because remember when we're talking about the example there, the down payment is part of the damages. So if you do it incorrectly, the higher the down payment, if you were to just make the decision on this borrower must be able to repay the loan because he or she's putting down 50%, that just increases the amount of the damages that the borrower would sue you for down the road if, in fact, you try and foreclose on that loan and they raise the defense that they did that the seller didn't properly consider the ability to repay. So, and that's something I think sellers need to keep in mind because these kinds of things are not going to be decided by the CFPB. I don't think, honestly, that the CFPB is going to get involved in individual cases between buyers and sellers. Although the CFPB does have a very robust complaint process, and sellers or buyers certainly would be free to complain, but it's more likely, I think, to come out in a lawsuit. And in the lawsuit, it'll be decided by a judge. And so if the seller decides not to retain the evidence that they consider, the evidence of what they considered in defining and deciding on the ability to repay, they need to consider how they're going to prove that to a judge. Again, another reason to have attorneys involved when you're doing this kinds of when you're doing these kinds of transactions. So, some additional considerations under federal law for sellers carrying back loans. I talked earlier about being a creditor, and those of you who may be students of the Truth in Lending Act know that. The Truth in Lending Act has always said that there is an exemption for five or fewer loans per year from the definition of a creditor. So prior to the ability to repay rule and everything going into play here, anyone who made five or fewer loans was exempt from being defined as a creditor, except that there were there's two caveats to that. And that is, when a seller carries back just one or two loans, if those loans are high-cost mortgage loans, as defined in HOPA, this is why HOPA is important, they would fall under the definition of a creditor. So for instance, if a seller were to carry back two high-cost mortgage loans, if they carry back more than one, so if they carry back just one high-cost mortgage loan, there's a possibility that they'd be exempt. However, if they engage a mortgage broker to help them with that loan, then the fact that it's a high-cost mortgage loan and a mortgage broker is involved, then they become a creditor with just one high-cost mortgage loan. They can do, if they do one high-cost mortgage loan without a mortgage broker, they're okay, but if they do a second one, then they are a creditor, even though they're still under the five threshold, because they're dealing in a high-cost mortgage loan. So that's, like I say, I don't think that's probably all that likely, but nevertheless, it's something that you need to be aware of. And once again, part of the reason why it's important to have an attorney involved when doing this kind of transaction as we go forward. Now, there are considerations under Colorado law as well that everybody needs to be aware of. And it works kind of the same way. So just as the Truth in Lending Act involves sellers carrying back loans through the definition of a mortgage loan originator, so does Colorado law. So in Colorado, there's a little bit different definition of what is a loan originator. And of course, in Colorado, if you're a mortgage loan originator, you need to be licensed. And this goes for realtors and sellers as well. So in Colorado law, the requirement is that, again, if you offer or negotiate terms of a residential mortgage loan, then you are a mortgage loan originator. Now, there is an exemption for sellers. Once again, person or estate or trust carrying back up to three loans in any 12-month period. Again, this is not the same as the federal exemption. But it does exempt sellers from from the requirement to be licensed as mortgage loan originators if they do fewer than three transactions in a year. But there's a catch in here, a catch-22 kind of a thing, that it's in, and I've again given the citations because anybody involved in this thing needs to really review the law and be careful that they're in compliance with it, which is why engaging an attorney makes sense. But in section 1261.911, there's a requirement that requires compliance with all of the federal lending laws. Even though you are exempt, you still have to comply with the federal lending laws, and which do contain, in addition to the federal laws, but also that section contains requirements with Colorado-specific disclosures as well. Now, in Colorado, real estate brokers aren't required to be licensed as mortgage loan originators solely because they represent a seller who will be carrying back seller financing. However, that only applies so long as the real estate broker confines himself or herself to real estate brokerage activities. And if someone goes outside those activities and does anything, again, offers or negotiate rates or terms, then they have to be licensed as a mortgage loan originator. There's also a similar exemption for real estate brokers in the federal level on the 2013 loan originator rule, so long as they stick to the real estate brokerage activities and are not compensated by a loan originator or a creditor. Same thing. In both cases, if you're dealing in offering or negotiating rates, you're most likely a loan originator and need to act accordingly. There are exemptions for attorneys as well. Now, in Colorado, an attorney is exempt as long as it's in the normal course of their practice and as long as they're a licensed Colorado attorney. Under the federal definition, it's a little bit less clear, but again, there is an exemption for them as well. So let's talk about briefly in the last couple of minutes here, what recommended best practices, I think. I think that loan originators or licensed mortgage loan originators, licensed mortgage broker, or licensed real estate brokers really are well advised to make sure that an attorney is involved in those and to refrain, especially real estate broker, refrain from acting as a loan originator by offering or negotiating terms unless you do have a loan originator license. But even then, you need to be very careful. A licensed mortgage loan originator needs to be careful that they are aware of all of the laws and compliant. For the vast majority of sellers, I think the seller financier one property exemption is likely going to meet their needs and serve them well. But remember, sorry, I got a little carried away there. Remember that even if a seller is exempt under the one property federal exemption, they are still bound by certain Colorado disclosure requirements. If the seller offers terms that would make the loan a high-cost mortgage loan and engages a mortgage broker to originate the loan, then they need to make sure whether that's going to make them a creditor. And if they do have to comply, if they are a creditor, they have to comply with the robust ability to repay rule, not the relaxed version that we were talking about, or the alternative version, alternative criteria that we were talking about in the seller financier 3 property exemption. And finally, be aware that that carrying back one loan under the, if a seller carries back one loan and they have more properties, they can't make another loan within that 12-month period unless that first loan meets those alternative criteria of the ability to repay rule. And so they need to make that decision early on. I've provided a list on the last slide here of additional resources. The CFPB mortgage rules at a glance, the good news and bad news. The bad news is the rules that comprise, that we're talking about, these 6 rules, are about 3,900 pages of rules and commentary. The good news is the CFPB provides what they call small business compliance guides. They're required to do that under federal law. And that's kind of a summary of the rules. The good news is there's a summary. The bad news is the summary of these 6 rules is 353 pages long. But each one is summarized individually. And you can find links, videos. The CFPB has a great website, and if you explore it and if you look on this mortgage rules at a glance, it's the quick link to all of the rules we just talked about to videos that talk about the rules, to the small business compliance guides that provide summaries of the rules. For sellers who need to look at the credit of a borrower, Experian has created a way for a consumer to share his or her credit report with a third party. There's a link to that. And then finally, I just want to make mention of two attorneys who helped me put this together, who helped me vet this presentation, Rick Accomazzo at Bloom Murren Accomazzo and Seiler, and then Deanne Stodden at the Stodden Law Firm, both of whom are knowledgeable in this area. And if you do have questions or comments and want to talk to somebody specifically about an individual transaction, both of them, I think, would be willing to spend some time and talk to you about it. So it's my pleasure to have been here, and I look forward to answering any questions that I might have. And I'll turn this back over to Wes. Thanks for the opportunity.
Absolutely. Thank you. And you hit the post right on the head there. So
that's rehearsal will do for you.
Exactly. So. Well, that's good. Great information. Obviously, you got through a lot of information in a short amount of time. And the slide deck that you put together is a great resource for our folks, and we would encourage you to save that and refer to that moving forward. We're going to take a quick break here, about 10 minutes. And the purpose for this break is to vet questions that have come in throughout the presentation. And what we're going to do is collect those. We'll review those during the break and come back and have a little discussion, answer as many as we can. This is your last opportunity to ask a question. So if you have any that have been kind of pondering on your mind or some situations that have come out there in the field, please go ahead and submit those to the email address there on the screen, and we'll look forward to seeing you at about 10 after the hour.
Great.
Thank you. Okay, welcome back. Thank you so much for all of your questions. It's going to give us a little bit of opportunity to have some discussion here. And let's just jump right into it, Terry.
Sure.
Which rules are the most significant in your mind that are going to have the most impact on our industry?
Well, I think the ones that have the most impact is the loan originator rule. From the standpoint of the seller financing side of things, the ability to repay rule, because it is impacting the way loans are done, and will pretty much impacts every transaction going forward. I think that's probably the one that will have the potential for the most impact. Like I say, because of the kinds of loans we've been making over the course of the last 2 or 3 years, I don't think that impact is likely to be as great as, say, it would have been if that rule had been instituted in 2005. Right. It would have had a huge impact on the way loans were being made then. But the market itself moved towards making safer and more carefully made loans without the ability to repay rule. Ability to repay is kind of the icing on the cake. I think the valuations rule, the ECOA valuations rule, because it introduces the possibility for the borrower to receive more than one indication of value, that could be something that confuses borrowers, and depending on the how concerned they are, how certain they are in terms of the transaction that they want to go through it. A lot of people think, for instance, that an appraisal is an absolute value. You know, that if a house is worth $250,000 on the appraisal, it's worth $250,000. Right. It's not worth $251,000. It's not worth $249,000. And I don't think there's an appraiser out there or a real estate broker for that matter, who would tell you that it's not that precise of a right. science. It's an art, not right. a science. And you're trying to get close right. to the value, but it ultimately depends on what a buyer or seller is willing to pay.
Right.
And then probably the fourth rule that maybe has some impact again, but I don't think it's going to be that much, as the high cost mortgage loan. To the extent that if you're dealing in an area where you do or consider hard money loans, then absolutely the HOPA rule will be impactful. Or if you have a seller who is trying to sell a property and wants to get 6, 5, 6, 7% higher rates, you know, if rates are 5% and they're looking to get 11
right.
Or 12,
right.
then that's something that would need to be right. come into play. But again, I don't think that's going to be.
Well, and a lot of them aren't going to have an impact on our industry now with the market conditions being what they are. But I think the intent is to help stabilize some of those conditions when the market is in more of those fluctuating states.
That's right.
You mentioned in your presentation that the CFPB has limited authority over smaller institutions. We have a lot of community banks and credit unions in Colorado. Where do they fit in the mix?
Well, the CFPB, again, the CFPB issues the rules. They have the rule-making authority. They do make some exemptions for smaller banks. So, for instance, we were talking about dual tracking. There's exemptions for smaller banks who service less than 5,000 loans, because again, the assumption is that they don't have a foreclosure department that's outsourced to an attorney over here,
right.
and they have somebody else doing loss mitigation. It's probably the same person
right.
Doing both of them, and so they're going to know, one hand is going to know what the other hand is
right.
doing. But again, the biggest difference is the CFPB makes the rules for everybody. They do provide some exemptions for smaller lenders. And then the other big difference is that the FDIC, rather than the enforcement action, those smaller banks would not be examined by the CFPB. They would be examined by their prudential regulator. So, for instance, that might be the OCC. For a bank, or it might be the National Credit Union Administration for a credit union.
Got it.
But if they're a big credit union or a big bank, so if their assets are over $10 billion, then the CFPB is their primary regulator, even though those other entities still have some influence. But it's the CFPB that'll do the examining for the big banks and big credit unions.
Got it. Well, it's good to see that there was some practicality worked in there.
Absolutely.
As you said, when the left hand knows what the right hand is doing, then the idea is that they're working toward the best intent in the industry there.
Right.
So you mentioned enforcement powers. Let's dive into that a little bit. There seems to be a little bit more discretion within the agency, the CFPB, than a lot of regulatory entities. What is your take on that? And are there some situations out there that our folks might inadvertently be finding themselves in on a day-to-day basis or out in the field that weren't issues before, because there's a lot of layers to it, but are issues now because of the new rules?
Well, actually, yes, I think there are. There are a couple of examples. We talked about the CFPB has the ability, the requirement that they enforce RESPA. Some of the issues under RESPA in terms of marketing agreements, and certainly there are marketing agreements between lenders and realtors many times. There are, so one of the things that we've seen is that, and there are desk rentals, kind of a thing, which, remember, RESPA prohibits the payment of things of value for referrals. And so, for instance, the CFPB just took an enforcement action against a mortgage lender who rented desk space from a bank in this case. This was a bank in Missouri and a mortgage lender in Missouri. They fined, the CFPB examined, obviously this was a complaint. Somebody reported this to the CFPB because the CFPB is not so far examining really small companies, kind of a thing. So this was probably part of a complaint that somebody made. And the CFPB, what they determined that there was a desk rental being paid by the mortgage company to this bank based on the volume of loans that were closing. Now, over the period of about 6 months, about 20 loans closed. The payments that were made to the bank wound up being roughly double. I think the CFPB determined that the market rate rent for that desk was about $650 a month, but the actual payments that were being made were closer to $1,300 a month. The CFPB said that's a violation of RESPA, it's a violation of Section 8, and they fined the mortgage company paying those payments $57,000. There were 20 loans involved in this situation, 20 loans involved, and the fine was $57,000. So the two things about that, number one, relative to what the CFPB is capable of, that's a very small case for 20 loans.
Right.
A $57,000 fine for 20 loans is a lot of money, considering that what they were talking about was an overpayment of $400 or $500 a month, for a period of 6 months, wound up with a $57,000 penalty,
and that's crippling.
Yes, absolutely. So those kinds of things. They've made it very clear that they are looking into advertising. They are looking into desk rentals, and we've not seen other than this. This has sort of been the one in enforcement action. But we know that also there was a company in Utah that was fined $13 million for violating the loan officer rule. And essentially the CFPB alleged that those loan officers were being paid higher compensation in order to, they were charging the borrower, putting the borrower into loans that had higher interest rates, and therefore violating the terms of the loan officer compensation because they were not supposed to get paid that additional amount of money. $13 million, $9 million of it went back to the borrowers. I think there were somewhere around 2,000 borrowers involved in that case. And $4 million of the fine went into the CFPB's fund. Because the CFPB finds not only does it, we talked about they can require restitution, which they did in this case. They required restitution to the borrowers that were involved, and they also fined the company beyond that.
Interesting.
So they've got teeth, and they are just getting
started.
They're
producing a lot of volume.
Yes. Yes. People are paying careful attention to what they're doing.
Let's talk about the valuations rule, because you mentioned reasonable fee. I know that this is apples and oranges, but this is something that comes up from our members a lot because their clients are asking them, well, what goes into determining a reasonable fee? So the valuations rule requires that the creditor send a copy of the appraisals and other other written valuations within 3 days of the application. They can charge a reasonable fee for that, but it also says that they can't charge per copy or for each page of paper that's used within that. What goes into determining the reasonable fee?
Well, I think at this point, this will be something that the CFPB will probably take more of a look at down the road in terms of what's reasonable. As they start to see the variations, if you will, in appraisal fees across the market. But for now, I don't think we really don't know what a reasonable fee is. I think the principal thing they're getting at in that rule is, number one, that within 3 days of the application, the borrower must be notified that they have the right to receive appraisals, or copies of all written valuations. And second, right now they have the right to receive it, but they have to ask for it. Now they're going to get it automatically.
Right.
And the other thing it does is it makes it clear to the lenders or anybody involved in the process of providing those copies that those copies are free. You can't raise your fees to accommodate for the appraisal fees, to the free appraisals that are going to be given to the buyer down the road.
Got it.
I think that's the main emphasis
kind
of the rule.
Out a little bit. And that's, that's a question that comes up in title and in a lot of areas of
right.
the industry. Let's talk a little bit about seller financing, because in my opinion, it's a big component. We got a couple of questions on this. You mentioned that the definition of a loan originator would also likely cover a real estate broker who is offering terms of a loan to a buyer on behalf of the seller, or who participated in the negotiation of rates, fees, loan terms, and so on. The standard line here, and you mentioned this, it's the same at CMLA in advising real estate broker colleagues, clients, is to not go down that road, to seek legal advice. But what are some common situations out in the field that our folks might find themselves in, even by accident, where they would be tiptoeing that line?
Well, I think just from my own experience and having bought a few homes and worked with a lot of realtors through the years, I think that the basic relationship between a customer and the realtor is that the realtor is the person that the customer naturally looks to for advice. They look to it for advice about what to do to sell their property, if they're a buyer, if they're a seller, which properties to look at if they're a buyer. So there's just this natural interplay that's the realtor is the expert. That's who they're going to look at probably first and foremost to give them advice. So I think, and what realtors need to be careful of is that when, certainly if you're talking about, well, the standard going rate is 4.75% or something like that, you've got to be careful not to get involved in, if you will, the offering. So if you're giving them an overview of what the market is, for interest rates and so forth, that's fine. But if it gets down to, it's just like if a loan originator were to say to you as a realtor, we're quoting 5% on our loan, and you were to turn around and say to the buyer, you can get 5% if you go see Joe Blow. I'd be careful about doing that. If there's a seller out there who's thinking about doing a seller carryback, and a realtor gets themselves involved in the middle of that by saying, I don't think that 3.5% is right. I think you should be at 4.5, or you should be at 5. And then the buyer comes back and says, well, I don't want to pay 5. Then, and if you wind up going back and forth between buyer and seller, fine-tuning the rates, you're acting as a loan originator, even though you're not necessarily taking an application.
So the general rule is to talk in generalities.
Right.
Advise, talk about situations, some previous things maybe that have happened in the past, so long as it is kind of a situational generality. But once you start talking specifically about that transaction, those loan terms, and you're starting to get involved in that negotiation process, it's hands off.
If you're considering, for instance, well, this buyer, maybe you know a little bit about the buyer, and so you know that the buyer's had credit issues. And so you say to the seller, I think we need to charge a little bit higher interest rate because there's a little more risk in this loan.
Right.
You can't do that kind of stuff.
Right.
Again, in those cases, I think you want to have somebody, a competent, qualified real estate attorney that you can turn to and let them sort of walk your person through the process of, and make sure that they are doing things properly and that they're not exposing themselves to unnecessary liability because they don't understand the nuances of this kind of a transaction either.
Right. So very quickly, and we just have a few minutes here, there were some specific questions came in. Talked about seller financing and balloon payments. They don't qualify under the exemptions. What if that was lumped into an LLC and they were providing the seller financing or they were carrying that back?
Okay, I think the exemption, first of all, the exemption is for the seller of the property. So if the seller of the property, and it's limited to an individual, a natural person, it's a natural person, an estate, or a trust. And so since an LLC is likely neither of those, so creating an LLC isn't gonna work.
Got it.
Yeah. So then
separately, let's say a seller can't afford to stage their home and they need to do some remodeling or staging while it's on the market. Can a broker lend them the money to do that? And then separately, how could the broker ensure that they get their money back after the sale?
Well, to the extent that the broker is considering taking back a note or a security interest in the property, again, I think the smart thing to do here would be to consult a real estate attorney.
Sure.
To me, that's the kind of a thing that I think it would be best left to an attorney. I don't think the CFPB rules necessarily would involve that. But again, if there's interest, if you're making a loan on a property to a consumer, you need to be aware of what these rules say.
Well, and it should be noted too that those situations are getting beyond the conversation of just the CFPB, that there's a lot of practical things that folks need aware of when they start heading down these situations. And if there are additional questions, consult a qualified attorney.
Well, their attorney or their broker, who is more likely going to have seen those kinds of circumstances.
Sure.
As we go forward from here.
And on that note, with regard to general legal advice, many of you I know already use this service, but as a reminder, CAR provides a CAR legal hotline that can be accessed by managing brokers in the office. There's more information that you can find on that at coloradorealtors.com under the Member Services tab. Terry, let's end on this. Digging through the papers this morning, and according to a report released by the CFPB here very recently, as of January 31st, the agency had received almost 200,000 complaints, but fewer than half of those actually concerned mistakes or lending mistakes. The vast majority of them involved servicing, loan modification, foreclosure activities by the servicers. Does that surprise you in any way, or is that the intent of the rules that we're looking at, or is that going to continue to be a trend moving forward? Just kind of what's your take on that?
Well, I think it doesn't surprise me. As I said before, the CFPB has a very robust complaint process. Now they're soliciting complaints on credit cards, student loans, and mortgages. The mortgage complaints have been predominantly servicing complaints, and of course the thing about the loans that were made in the 2000s, those resulted in a lot of servicing complaints. That's why you've seen the national servicing settlement. That's why you see the CFPB servicing rule is a very big thing. I think that going forward, the rules that will have more impact will be, like I said, the ability to repay. Certainly the servicing rule is meant to address those kinds of problems, those complaints that came out of the mortgage meltdown, as it's sort of popularly called.
A lot of those problems happen in disclosure and transparencies when the loans are sold, and that handoff occurs, and that's been a
problem. Well, and the kind of loans, and some of the kinds of loans that were made, did lend themselves to more problems, as well as a lot of the servicing problems came about because nobody, I think, in the industry, nobody anticipated the volume. Nobody anticipated that home prices would fall to the extent that they did. And so when they did, and as home prices fell because the economy was not doing well, people were losing jobs, and those are the things that lead to loan servicing problems.
Right.
And now, as the economy is doing better, I think we're gradually emerging from that. But we have a ways to go yet.
Right.
And we're still in still a fragile recovery, even though it does seem to be getting stronger day by day.
That's an appropriate place to end. We're out of time.
Wes,
thank you so much.
Thank you.
Terry.
My pleasure.
We appreciate again your time and expertise this morning, and thank you for joining us. Just as a reminder, we have a full schedule of live webcasts coming up throughout the spring season, although we're not quite there yet. I'd love to be. It's awfully cold today, but in any case, you can find those at coloradorealtors.com. That's it from here. Take care and enjoy the rest of your day.